Thank you so much for the invitation. Today, I would like to talk about relation between non-commutative cumulants from Magnus expansion. So, first of all, I would like to recall some preliminaries in the commutative case. So, in a classical probability space, we have random variables. We know that if X and Y are independent random variables, then we have these identities. The expectation of the product is the product of the expectations. Okay? But then, if we want to just abstract the algebraic part of this identity, then we can think that the notion of independence is just a rule to compute mixed moments. In this case, the mixed moments of X and Y. So, if we want to have a non-commutative version of independence, then we can just try think as a rule to compute mixed moments, and for each notion of independence, we can have versions, for instance, of convolutions, central limit theorems, and cumulants. So in the previous talk, Frederick talked about the free case, the free independence. So just the definition of a non-commutative probability space is just a pair where H is a unital algebra over C, associative, and phi is just a linear function, just as phi of the unit of A is just one. The examples of a non-commutative probability space is the classical probability space. If we consider the algebra of random variables which has all their moments, for the linear function that we consider the expectation, then this pair is a non-commutative probability space that, well, actually this is commutative. But for instance, if we consider the algebra of D times D matrices, and for the linear function that we consider the normalized trace, this is a non-commutative probability space also. And again, we can combine both examples, and actually the algebra of random matrices is also a non-commutative probability space. So, Frederick told us the definition of free independence. In this talk, I will consider also the notion of Boolean and monotone independence. Well, the definition of the rules for computing the moments of Boolean or monotone independence are not very important of this talk, but I just want to mention that. For instance, if we have random variables and, well, subalgebras of A and elements in the subalgebras such that consecutive elements do not belong to the same algebra, subalgebra, then we say that the subalgebras are freely independent if the moment of the product is equal to zero, always that the variables has zero mean. We say that the subalgebras are Boolean independent if the factorization is just the moment of the product is the product of the moments. And for the monotone case, we also have to assume that the set of index has a linear order. And then we say that the moments that the subalgebras are monotone independent if this factorization holds. Okay. So now I want to define the corresponding notions of cumulants. In order to do this, I need some combinatorial objects. The each of them are the non-crossing partition. Well, here we have the pictorial definition of what a non-crossing partition is. We draw the blocks of a partition of the numbers 1 to n as, well, in this form. And we say that the partition is non-crossing if we don't have something like this. Here we have a partition with blocks 1, 4, the red one, 2, 3, 5, the blue one, and 6. And when we draw the blocks, we always find this crossing. When we don't have such crossing, we say that the partition is non-crossing. Specific examples of partition are also the irreducible non-crossing partitions. Those are partitions such that the 1 and the n belong to the same block. And we also have the notion of interval partitions, are partitions whose blocks are intervals. In particular, any interval partition is a non-crossing partition. Given a non-crossing partition, we have a partial order on the blocks of the partition just by saying that one block is smaller than another if only if the second one is nested in B. For instance, in this non-crossing partition pi, the block that contains the number 2 is larger than the block that contains the 1, and the block that contains 6 is larger than the block that contains 4 and the block that contains 1. This order, partial order, can be encoded by the tree of nesting of a non-crossing partition. In the case of irreducible, I mean the one is connected by the last one, this is a tree, but in the case that for a general non-crossing partition, we will have a forest of trees, where each forest is associated to the irreducible components of the non-crossing partition. By irreducible components, I mean these blocks. These two blocks is one irreducible component, and the other one is this. Another type of non-crossing partition are the monotone non-crossing partitions. Those partitions are just non-crossing partitions equipped with a total order that refines the previous partial order. If we want to know what is the number of monotone partitions that we can associate to a given non-crossing partition, we need a useful quantity is the trifactorial of a tree. In general, for any rooted tree, we define the trifactorial recursively by if the T is just the single vertex tree, the factorial of the tree is 1. Otherwise, is the product of these three factorials, where each SI is a subtree of T. I mean, if we have S1 and SN, and then if we consider if we attach to a new common root all the subtrees, we obtain T. And finally, the number of monotone non-crossing partitions, we can prove that is given by this quantity. This is the size, the number of vertices that the tree of nesting of pi, that is the same as the number of blocks of pi. Okay. And finally, in order to define cumulants, this also was mentioned by Frederick, if we have a family of multilinear functionals, and we consider a non-crossing partition which blocks B1, BK, and the elements of the blocks are ordered in this form, increasingly, then we define the restriction of F by the block B, by just evaluating the F of order, the size of B, in this case is M, and the arguments are those A's whose indexes are the elements of B. And the multiplicative extension of this family to the family of non-crossing partitions, F pi, is just given by the product of the previous quantities, and the product is over all the blocks of pi. An example, for instance, if we have this non-crossing partition, and this case is a non-crossing partition on 9 elements, then F of pi is just when this block it contains 1, 3, and 9. This is a tree, sorry. F3 of A1, A3, A9. Then for this block is just one element, it's F1 of A2. For this block of three elements is F3 of A4, A5, A8. And this is not a comma, it's a product. F2 of A6, A7. Okay? And then the definition of cumulants for the free, the Boolean, and monotone. Those are families of multilinear functionals that are recursively defined by the following expression, that are the so-called moment cumulant formulas. I say that this is a recursive definition because if we split this sum by just taking the partition with just one element, just one block, then this term in the sum is the product of just one element, that is the cumulant of order n. Mm-hmm. And the other terms are products of cumulants of lower order. So we can use this formula to recursively define free cumulants. Here, this is the set of non-crossing partitions for the free case. For the Boolean case, it's the same formula, except that we are considering the sum over the interval partitions of set 1 to n. And for the momentum cumulants, the sum is also over the non-crossing partition, but now we consider this this coefficient. And by this formula, we can write this formula also in terms of monotone partitions. Okay. So the cumulants satisfy very nice properties to study non-commutative probability. So one natural question is if there are relations between cumulants. And in a paper of Arismendi, Hasebel, and Vargas, they proved that the cumulants can be written in terms of other cumulants by a similar formula that for the that of moment cumulant formula, but now we are considering the set of irreducible non-crossing partitions. Here we have how to write the Boolean in terms of free, the free in terms of Boolean, the Boolean in terms of monotones, and the free in terms of monotones. In their paper, they also proved the formula to write monotone in terms of Boolean and free, but just for the univariate case. The multivariate case was still open, and this is the content of our joint work. Okay. For the following, I would like to mention the tools that we use to find the corresponding multivariate formula to write down monotone in terms of free and Boolean. Okay. We want to express multivariate monotone cumulants in terms of free and Boolean. And for this, we will use the following Prelie framework. Given a non-commutative probability space, we consider this ideal in the tensor algebra. And then the family of multilinear functionals that are the cumulants can be viewed as linear forms in the dual of this algebra. Just by defining that if I have a word, A1, AN, kappa of this word is given by the n free cumulant of A1 to AN, and kappa for the free, beta for the Boolean, and rho for the monotone. And the fifth result is that the dual is actually a Prelie algebra. What does I mean? If I define this product, by this expression, then it satisfies the left Prelie identity. Observe that this sum can be written in terms of irreducible non-crossing partitions that have two blocks, because what we are doing here is just subtract a non-empty subword from the word W. And such non-empty subword in the middle is evaluated in alpha, and the remaining subword is evaluated in beta. Okay. And where does this really product come from? From the Frederick's talk, we know that the double tensor algebra is actually the dual of the double tensor algebra is a so-called shuffle algebra. So, in other words, in this double tensor algebra, we have the following good product that can be split into two parts. For each of these parts, we consider the dual, and of the coproduct, we have an associative product, and for the half coproducts, we have two non-associative products. And the three products are related in a nice way that it's called a non-commutative shuffle algebra or tendriform algebra. And for a general shuffle algebra, we can show that if we define this product by using this half product, then this is a Prelie product. Okay. now I want to talk about the Magnus expansion. The motivation of this for the classical Magnus expansion is if we consider the following matrix valued initial problem, this Y and A's are matrices, this initial value problem is equivalent to the following fixed point equation for Y. And when it's possible to show that when the matrices A commute, then the solution of this problem is given by this exponential. But what happens when we don't have this commutativity assumption? The solution has the form of this time order exponential, but if one insists in having an exponential, a solution, then Magnus in 1954 showed that the solution is given by this exponential, where this omega satisfies the following relation. Here, this adds correspond to the adjoint endomorphism that is given by the commutator of omega and A. Well, actually, that is a Lie bracket. And here, the Bn are the Bernoulli numbers. OK. But now, in the previous example of Prelie algebra, well, we have a Prelie product. But what happens if now, in this formula, instead of having this iterated Lie bracket, we have the iterated Prelie product? The Prelie Magnus expansion is given by the same expression, just by having this iterated Prelie product from the left. And this omega prime has a compositional inverse given by this series. And one of the main results of Ebrahim Efar and Patras in 2015 is that the linear forms associated to the monotone kappa and beta, the monotone free and Boolean cumulants are related through the Prelie Magnus expansion. Okay, so in this framework, we have how to write the monotone cumulants in terms of the free and Boolean cumulants, but we would like to obtain a formula in terms of non-crossing partition. So, well, we have this expression for the Prelie Magnus expansion, but now our approach is then write these iterated Prelie products in terms of as a sum over non-crossing partition. And with this idea, we have obtained the following result. In general, if we have a sequence of iterated Prelie product from the left, this sequence of iteration of Prelie product has this expression, where here the sum is over the irreducible monotone partition with n plus 1 blocks. And in other words, pi is given by the sequence because we are considering the order of the blocks. The sequence given by the blocks b1 to bn plus 1, where, and since we are considering the irreducible, b1 is a block that contains the 1 and the last and dm. And as a corollary, since we want to obtain this expression for kappa and omega prime of kappa that we know that it is rho, we obtain the following expression. At the end, we are not considering, we are not considering the sum over monotone partition because the order is not important in this case because we are just doing the product by the same rho. So we can write this sum in terms of non-crossing partition. But we have to multiply by the number of monotone prime partition associated to pi. Okay. And well, the last ingredient for our formula are the so-called Murua's coefficient. So the other definition is if we have a non-crossing partition pi, reducible, then we define the number omega k of pi to be the number of surjections that are strictly order preserving. Doesn't mean that if we have two blocks in pi, we know that in pi we have a partial order structure. then we are counting all the surjections that satisfy this condition. And we define the numbers omega k by this formula. Here we have some examples of omega. For instance, for the ladder tree, for this with four vertices, we have that omega of 1, 2, 3 are equal to 0. And for omega 4, this is just 1, because this is just one order preserving surjection. And then this number is just minus 1 over 4. And the argument is the same for the ladder with m vertices. Okay. And well, finally, the formula. The coefficient that we are looking for are precisely those given by the Murua coefficient of the tree of next things of pi. Mm-hmm. So it's a sum, again, over irreducible non-crossing partition. And we observe that if we go back to the formulas obtained by Arismendi et al., the difference between free and Boolean is this minus 1 to the number of log minus 1 coefficient. And this also appears in the other formulas. Okay, so just to finish, I would like to say a little bit of our recent work. The moment cumulant formulas for the free and the Boolean case can be inverted by using Möbius inversion. But that is not the case for the monotone case, because the coefficients that we have, 1 over the 3 factorial of pi, don't satisfy multiplicativity conditions, something like that. And then having a formula, a closed formula in terms of non-crossing partitions was still an open question that I was interested in. And just to say the formula, we use the notion of Schroeder trees that are just planar rooted trees that whose internal vertices has at least 2 descendants. Here, I have some examples of Schroeder trees. The skeleton of a Schroeder tree is just the subtree given by the internal vertices. And for instance, here we have a Schroeder tree. And we have the skeleton that is given by this tree. And given a Schroeder tree, we can construct a non-crossing partition given by the corollas. For instance, if we decorate the sectors between the leaves, for instance, this is the 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and then we write down the numbers 1, well, we give the decoration, and then the block of the partition pi is given by the numbers below the corollas. For instance, here for this block, we have 1, 5, 6, then for this 2, 3, 4, 7, and 8, 9, 10. Hmm? And Schroeder trees are very important here because we can construct a Hopf algebra where the coproduct is given by the non-commutative version of the Kohn-Schreimer coproduct. Mm-hmm. We have that this with this coproduct, this is a connected graded Hopf algebra where the degree of a tree is given by the number of leaves minus 1. And if we have a set, in particular, we will use the algebra of the non-commutative probability space. We have that the decorated version of this Hopf algebra is again a Hopf algebra. And a result proved in 2019 showed that the double tensor algebra introduced by Ebrahim Ikhfar and Patras can be related with this decorated the Hopf algebra of the decorated Schroeder trees by this map iota that turns out to be a coalgebra morphism. And using such map, we can give a formula that writes monotone cumulants in terms of the moments as follows. If we consider the if we have an element in the previous Hopf algebra, then we define this this map, this algebra morphism, to be a character just by saying that this is equal to this moment if this a corolla and zero otherwise. Then it is possible to prove that the logarithm of this character is, well, it's an infinitesimal character, and when we compose with the map Jota, what we obtain is the linear form rho associated to the monotone cumulants. And then the formula that writes down monotone cumulants in terms of the moments is just, well, in a principle, is a sum over the set of Schroeder trees with n plus one ellipse. And again, the Murua coefficient appears. When we group all the non-crossing partitions that are associated to the, all the trees that are associated to the same non-crossing partition, well, we have that this is the respective coefficient associated to any non-crossing partition in the formula that writes the monotone in monotone cumulants in terms of moments.
Yes, the Murua coefficients they appear in a numerical analysis for a backwards analysis characters, mm-hmm. and they are associated to non-planar rooted trees. So my question is: the rooted tree associated to a non-crossing partition, is it planar or not? They are planar.
Yes.
Yes. But you consider the Murua coefficient of the associated non-planar tree, right? Mm-hmm. Okay.
Thank you. Naive question, because I think I failed to understand how the co-product in these Schroeder trees work. So you said it's Konkheimer, but then how does it?
The usual Konkheimer is commutative. The algebra is a algebra of commutative polynomials, but here the algebra that we're considering is non-commutative.
Yeah, my question is more on how it treats the decorations. I think I didn't understand that. So your decorations are kind of between branches, not really in the tree, or?
Like, yeah, exactly.
Yeah. So how, I mean, if you cut a tree, then what do you do with that decoration?
Sorry, again? The decoration is you have to keep track of the decoration for the coproduct.
Okay.